was in the year 1364 that an English Act of Parliament forbade anyone below a certain income to wear bejewelled costume, and others below another level of income to wear any embroidery. Throughout the medieval period, European courts and high-ranking church officials impressed each other and their subjects by wearing costumes, by bearing banners, and making hangings for the wall, all from fabulous fabrics that reinforced an image of high status and great power. Embroidery became an important decorative device that enriched and ennobled these devices, and it was utilized to great effect for hundreds of years by both the state and church. Today, its glory is still maintained by societies of people with great skill and patience who enjoy royal or government patronage so they may carry on these time-honoured traditions. Embroidering on woven textiles can be the measure of the development of an individual as they master such a skill. It has been in the past and is also still today a measure for the development of a society from its early beginnings. It was probably the process of developing methods of manufacturing, patching and mending clothes that led to developing different stitching techniques, opening the way for other creative possibilities. Producing different styles of images of three-dimensional quality using only a needle and thread is nothing short of amazing. The skills that have evolved from its refinement over the centuries today attract millions of people around the world to either view historic textiles in museums and galleries or to take up the challenge of producing their own. As the known borders of their world expanded, Europeans were able to draw on many different cultural sources for inspiration to embellish their garments with fine embroidery for personal, state, and ceremonial use. They used the same basic techniques of stitches, which are a feature of the earliest work from 5 centuries before Christ, and include what we now know as chain stitch, blanket stitch, running stitch, satin stitch, and cross stitch. The Bayeux tapestry on display at Bayeux in Normandy in the north of France dates from the 11th century, and it has been a subject of controversy for hundreds of years. Its title is why so many people get confused, because it's not a tapestry at all, but an embroidery on linen, as well as a document of great historical significance. It records the story associated with the invasion of England by the Normans and the result of the Battle of Hastings, which the Normans won in 1066, led by William, known as the Conqueror. Embroidered in wool yarn on a linen ground, using a simple stem stitch as well as couching techniques, the Bayeux tapestry illustrates in a naive style contemporary warfare and provides a comprehensive record of 11th century costume, the social history of the time, details about methods of transportation, as well as designs and styles of architecture and furniture. It also documents important information on nature and language, so in every sense this textile must be considered one of the most important historical documents we still have. At 0.5 metre high and 70 metres in length, it is an extraordinary feat of creativity and workmanship. The current opinion of many academics is that it was not produced in France at all, but in England. However, as it is an important aspect of commerce in Bayeux today, no one can really see that the people of that city would give it back, and there are a number of copies that have been made of it now in existence, including one on display in the Museum of Reading in Berkshire in England. Following the birth of Christ, Roman conquests around the Mediterranean and Aegean Sea, as well as in Britain, had brought new aspects of craftsmanship to bear on all art forms, including needlework. As the organized Christian church emerged after 3 centuries of more or less oppressed existence, it was inevitable that a hierarchical structure establishing the apostolic ministry of bishop, priest, and deacon, as related in the Acts of the Apostles written by Luke, would emerge. To distinguish those called to the vocation of a priestly life, garments would be developed to distinguish the clergy from the laity, and it is only natural that they would evolve from garments worn for Roman secular life. From the earliest period, the Roman tunic evolved into various types of clergy dress, and by the end of the 5th century, under the influence of the Byzantine Church, clerical dress began to be distinctly and permanently fixed. The preserved Roman mosaics at Ravenna in Italy are a helpful source for styles. Roman Emperor Justinian, 527 to 565, and his followers are featured wearing the long tunica alba, which came to be regarded as a dress of special dignity and the main garment worn in the Christian church for some 2,000 years. Made from linen, the tunica alba was required to be clean and white, indicating purity, continuing a Roman and Jewish custom of wearing white at ceremonies. The more linen is washed, the whiter it becomes, whereas wool fades to yellow and ceases to look pure. Within a short time, an embroidered panel, known as apparel, was sometimes added to the cuffs and hem of the tunica alba, which became the undergarment for many other vestments as they developed, and it was always worn with a girdle and amice. The amice was a rectangle of white linen worn as a neckcloth to prevent more costly outer vestments from being spoiled by perspiration. It was and still is the first vestment to be donned, covering the head and shoulder, this crossed over the breast and held in place by two long tapes around the body. After the alb and other vestments are then put in place, the amice is rolled back, the head left uncovered for celebration. The girdle went around the waist. Transformed in the 10th century, it became a wide belt of white or coloured material that could be then embellished with woven or embroidered designs, precious stones and gold thread. However, in the Latin Church, a long white rope or cord with tasselled ends was more generally used in a form that has survived to the present day. John, Bishop of Marseille, in his will of 1345, made a special bequest of his alb that was wrought with English orphreys. An orphrey is a piece of woven or embroidered fabric mainly applied to the vestments worn for the Eucharist or Mass. In the Middle Ages, orphreys included gold thread, and it is assumed that their name may have derived from Orphrygia or Phrygian gold. Phrygia was an ancient country between the Mediterranean and Black Sea in what is now central Turkey. The Phrygian kings contributed many Oriental ideas to the early Greeks, especially in music. And the Phrygian fisherman's hat, as well as being the model for the Doge at Venice's headwear, was also worn by French revolutionaries. The term opus anglicanum, or English work, is met in inventories in France, Italy, and Spain. Couched, pure gold threads were laid on the fabric surface and sewn to it at regular intervals. They were used expansively in the background for figure work that were then embroidered in gloriously coloured silks. Another characteristic of opus anglicanum was the modelling and wonderful expressions created by needle and thread. The very best pieces of opus anglicanum are gloriously detailed, and splendid works were exported to the Low Countries, France and Italy. The Vatican at Rome has more English needlework than any other museum with such textiles, and opus anglicanum appears to have reached the height of its popularity during the 13th century, when embroidered bookbinding became very popular. The cover of the filbrick psalter was worked by a nun in the convent of minoresses at Brusiard in Suffolk during the latter half of the 14th century. And a filbrick was very deft at couched gold thread and split stitch work. Its durability against wear and tear was a direct result of the couching thread being on the reverse side where it was protected. Then, if a thread was accidentally broken, it did not give way along an entire line. The couching was done in such a way it often formed geometric patterns on its own, such as lozenges, fleur-de-lis or brick patterns, and sometimes jewels and beads were also included. Early 20th century embroidery historians note the distinct period of achievement for Opus Anglicanum as between 1250 and 1509. However, an English embroidery historian, Lanto Singh's Opus, The Art of Needlework, published in 2001, he detailed its high point as between 1275 and 1350, with decline starting with the Black Death in 1348. This was when so many of those men involved in the work that was carried out in the professional workshops that abounded at London where they filled domestic and foreign orders were dying. The pallium represented the cosmopolitan aspect of the empire and had been worn by Jesus the Christ and his apostles, as well as the philosophers and intellectuals of the Greek classical world. By the 14th century, it was a symbolic style of stole that represented the fullness of episcopal authority. Worn, wrapped around the body with one third hung in front from the left shoulder to the knee and enveloping the upper arm, the remaining two thirds was drawn across the back, under the right arm, across the front, and again thrown over the left shoulder, where it was fastened or draped over the left forearm. St. Peter himself wore a pallium with his tunic, according to Clement of Rome. Usually white, it was without decoration except where small tapestry or embroidered designs were applied to each of its four corners. The dalmatic was an ungirdled short tunic and a foreign importation from Dalmatia, which was famous for the rich and skillful decoration of its garments. It became the dress of church deacons, from the Greek diakonos, meaning servant, who ranked below the priest, and it often had patches of embroidery on the brightest and richest of colours in silks and fine wools that stood out like gems against the tunic. The stole, or aerarium, was a narrow strip of material made of white wool or coloured silk, worn over the shoulders in various ways as an indication of the rank of the Roman official who first wore it. It was also adopted by the church, and by the first half of the 6th century we find Isidore of Pelusium saying, "The aerarium in white wool was a symbol of the lost sheep around the good shepherd's shoulders." Historically, a priest wears it crossed at the chest and tucked through his girdle to hang down. The bishop wears it hanging straight down and has it fixed by his girdle, whereas the deacon wears it over one shoulder. As with all other vestments, it eventually became an elaborate piece, gaining embroidery and sometimes semi-precious stones. The maniple derived from the mappa, a practical rectangle of linen which developed into an emblem of rank in pre-Christian Roman culture. It was held in the right hand of the consul because he had no pockets, and he often waved it as a sign for the games to start. It ended up as a folded object worn on the left forearm and was later transformed into a symbolic miniature embroidered stole worn over the left forearm. It represents the towel used by Christ at the washing of the feet of his disciples. As an aside, it's interesting to note that the Romans did not consider wearing trousers at all, as they were a form of dress associated with the migratory hordes of people, and in works of art from ancient Rome, trousers are frequently used to portray foreigners. It wasn't until the 3rd century that trousers began to be worn more generally in the West and became the precursor of modern male attire. However, they bear no relation to the development of ecclesiastical dress, as even in northern climes they never appeared in any church or monastery. The The use of embroidered banners in festal processions is of ancient origin. The Anglo-Saxon scholar, theologian, and historian, the Venerable Bede, related how St. Augustine and his priests arrived in England in the 6th century, carrying a silver cross and a banner with the figure of the Lord. These became richly embroidered, and a safe, effective pattern consisted of a figure of a saint in a tabernacle. Throughout the medieval period, European royal and princely courts impressed each other and their subjects with luxurious costumes designed to emphasize and reinforce their status and power. Great symbolism was attached to many of the designs rendered, and heraldic embroidery was an important decorative device because it reflected recognition of patronage. The chasuble, from the Latin chasula, became the principal vestment used by the priest for celebration of the Mass. Made initially from wool and then silk, embroidered all over and sometimes set with pearls and semi-precious stones, there was a point that they became so heavy the priest had great difficulty performing the manual acts of the Mass. This was when, as an art form, embroidery ranked in dignity with sculpture and painting. It was one of the most important subjects of instruction in medieval convents and monasteries, and not only was its production a business or profession, it was also a favourite pursuit. Many monasteries record the handiwork of the monks, and even abbots did not consider it beneath their dignity to embroider. The mitre was the official headwear of bishops and was being worn by the end of the 11th century by all Western bishops, as well as many abbots. At first, it was only a simple white cap. However, during the 12th century, it became one of the seven vestments worn by a bishop, signifying purity and chastity. The mitre had two lappets that hung down the back that gained elaborate embroidery as part of the processional insignia of individual bishops. It was also a sign of temporal power rather than assuming liturgical significance. The mitre also gained embroidered orphreys on the front and back, and the headband was often inset with gems and pearls embroidered with inscriptions. The cope was a ceremonial version of an outdoor cloak, worn during the latter days of the Roman Empire. It became established during the 11th and 12th centuries as part of the ceremonial vestments worn at non-Eucharistic ceremonies in the church, that is, baptism, marriage, and processions. By the 13th century, English clerics were wearing copes embroidered with gold and with attached gold-worked orphreys depicting saints and symbols of the church. The Sion cope, made between 1300 and 1320, is considered one of the finest examples of Opus Anglicanum. It is embroidered on linen with a fabulous orphrey and outer band depicting heraldry, and it was taken away to the continent in the 14th century by Brigittine nuns fleeing the dissolution of the monasteries by Henry VIII. They carried it through Flanders, France, and Portugal. And when they eventually returned to England in 1830, they brought it back with them. England's Earl of Shrewsbury is recorded as showing great kindness to the nuns, and in return, they presented him with this, their most precious relic. Although they had little intrinsic liturgical significance, copes lent splendour and magnificence to great feasts and ceremonies, and became an important addition worn by the principal officer at the Mass in procession. Copes detailed in the inventory of Christ Church at Canterbury in England, worn by Lanfranc, the Archbishop of Canterbury, 1070 to 1089, are recorded as being embroidered with gold and gold tassels. Originally, all copes had a hood, but as it had become increasingly ceremonial, the hood ceased to be functional, and it was reduced to a decorative element on the back of the garment. It was also often made in the colour appropriate to the church season or position of the wearer. It was during the 12th century that liturgical colours were first set down as special to a season of the church. However, it's worth noting all these colours were not taken too seriously until the 19th century in England, because many churches still continue to prefer to use the most splendid of their embroidered vestments for important festivals, irrespective of colour. The church has always been an outstanding keeper of records, and despite the ransacking of monasteries, fire and destruction through warfare, many have survived to provide us with some comprehensive inventories and detailed accounts of the vestments that existed. It was the quality of the textiles and quantity of rich silks or silver and gold threads that made up the rich vestments worn to the glory of God that were the most important. Many of them were also woven with silk in a variety of forms used, including damask, taffeta, a plain thick woven silk imported from Persia, and the penultimate of all, velvet. The fabric we know as velvet made its appearance in the closing years of the 13th century, and motifs such as roses, double-headed eagles and fleur-de-lis, pomegranates and other designs were worked on linen and applied to quality velvet. There is a glorious example of a purple velvet coat dating from about 1500 at the V&A Museum at London, decorated in the middle with the Assumption of the Virgin Mary, while on the scrolls held by the three surrounding angels is the legend, Gloria in Excelsis Deo. The dissolution of the monasteries and after effect of the Reformation in England in the 16th century would see the cessation of ecclesiastical embroidery. A wholesale destruction of vestments and other embroideries took place as the command was given that altars all over the country should be pulled down and destroyed and plain tables placed in their stead. Some people managed to save these extraordinary textiles that had taken years of work by many people by hiding them. Some were cut down as hangings for domestic use, and many men's private parlours were decorated with copes rather than carpets. Take your needle, my child, and work at your pattern. It will come out a rose by and by. Life is like that, one stitch at a time, taken patiently, and the pattern will come out all right, like embroidery, one of the threads of our destiny.